Are you just getting into the world of ephemera and have no idea how you should store your items? Do you want to start a junk journal and are unsure of the process, like me? Then I think you will like today's video where I explore both of those things as we delve into the world of paper. Hello everyone and welcome to Paper and Mousse and welcome to Ephemera Day. I have been asked by a few people over the course of my content creator career how to store paper or how do I store paper. And similar to how you make a junk journal, how you make a scrapbook, how you make a video, how you edit a video, there are thousands upon thousands of different ways. So I'm just going to show you what works for me, and perhaps some of my thoughts and ideas will be things that you haven't thought of, and it might work for you, because buying ephemera, storing ephemera is different for everyone because of several different factors. The space that you have, the money that you have, the time that you have. So lots of factors go into just the simple storage of paper. So let's get into it. First, I think we need to distinguish between paper that has a monetary and or sentimental emotional value versus the paper that you're going to use in crafting, junk journaling, card making, scrapbooking, etc. Those two papers should be stored differently. You do not want to store your precious photos of your great 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 uncle Al in, you know, a shoebox. You don't want to store your Civil War diaries in a shoebox. Paper that you're going to cut, tear apart, sew into book pages, you can store those in a shoebox. In the world of storing paper that has a value, again, whether it's monetary value or a personal emotional value, they do make archival storage boxes and lignin-free paper, which means it's paper that does not have a type of like fiber or polymer that's going to break down over the years and cause leakage of acid or acidic elements onto your precious documents. There are many different websites where you can buy the archival boxes, paper, file folders, from Amazon to websites and places that sell only archival materials. So price points are all over the board. I don't want to recommend one because it might not fit your price point, it might not fit your storage area, it might not be what you like. So if you are interested in looking up archival storage materials, then I suggest go to the good old internet and take a little look. But I would definitely, if you have papers, photographs, old letters that are near and dear to your heart, or if they are something that's worth a lot of money, then I would want to store them. I would suggest that you store them in archival boxes, and perhaps going really up far here, even to store them in fire safes so that in the event anything would happen, your documents would be preserved from both fire and water damage. So those are the documents that are super important to you. Now, for everything else, there are a variety of different ways to store those items. Where you store them, attics and basements, unless you have a home that has some kind of temperature, heating element, cooling element in both an attic and a basement, I would suggest not storing your paper there. It can become very brittle. The fluctuation of heat and coolness is not good for paper. So perhaps you have a nice closet in a spare room in an office, or if you have a basement that's finished and done and it has heat during the winter, then by all means store it there. If you have an attic that is done, you know, and has air conditioning during the summer and heat during the winter, then you can obviously store it there. But I would really kind of just urge you to not store your paper where there is a large fluctuation of hot and cold, because that's how it becomes brittle, it's how it becomes damaged, And sometimes that's how it becomes stinky as well. So let's get to your regular paper storage, paper that you're going to be using for crafting. You're cutting it up, you're gluing it, you're doing whatever. I use a variety of boxes, I guess you could say. I fortunately have a closet in my one bedroom that has all built-in shelves. There's built-in like little cubby holes. It's really quite neat. And so I store books on there just as is. I store some of my albums on there just as they are, if they don't need to be put into archival boxes for storage. Though I could store them in the closet in the archival boxes, because the closet is in a temperature regulated area and it's also cool. Well, not cool. It's also dark. Don't want to keep your good paper out in the sunlight. But anyway, so there's a variety of methods, and sometimes what works for you for a few years might not work for another year. So there's always different ways that you can change up how you store things depending on where you store them. Now, what I've come to love are these boxes. This is from Michaels, and I buy these when they are on sale, and they are usually on sale in the beginning of the new year. I also buy them when they're on sale and when I have a coupon and when I have a gift card. I think when they're on sale, they're $15 or maybe $12. But again, with my coupon and gift card, I don't really pay anything. Otherwise, they're a little bit pricier. So it's plastic. It has the carrying handle, and then it opens up to reveal all these little compartments. The one thing that I do not like about the case, which I realized after, is that it doesn't sit flat. See, and some of them fall out. So when you kind of open it, you kind of have to tilt it. But I absolutely love all the little boxes. I store postcards in here that I'm going to be either selling or potentially using later on for crafts. I store all the little bits of paper that I've been cutting, little booklets and things that I find in my travels. And then I have little labels, and I put them on the side. So this one, I have sewing, animals, flowers, science, maps, and then just regular text. We have pixie, food, ads, people. Now, I mean, if your paper is thin enough and small enough, you can hold a heck of a lot in here. You know, there are many people that have amazing channels that focus just on paper crafts, and there's no way that this would hold all their inventory. I am slowly now going through a lot of the books and materials that I purchase at flea markets, and you know, going through each thing, deciding what I want to cut out, what I want to keep, do I want to keep the book whole, etc. Because in the past, what I've done with having a YouTube channel, you know, you buy things because you want to show the excitement and the treasures that you find at a flea market, auctions, estate sale. Oftentimes, we focus first on the things that bring us the most joy, whether we're researching or listing. The other items kind of get pushed to the side. And so there comes a point when you gotta get to those items that have been pushed to the side. And that's what I've been doing now. So I go through those, cut them up, see what I wanna save, what I wanna use, etc. So this is one method I have for storing. These might not work for you. I like them. I think they're convenient and loud when you shut it. And I like that you can see through this. So I can easily stack these up in my one closet and just pull one out and know immediately where the, you know, the ad little compartment is. Now, what about larger paper, Renee? Because this is not going to hold big paper. Well, I have some other thing. So there's also the clear scrapbook cases. Michaels has these, Hobby Lobby has them. And again, I purchase mine when they're on sale. Now, you can hold a good amount in here, and oftentimes when I'm going through my paper, if I don't have time to sort it into the little sections, I'll just lump it all in here first and then go back through and sort again. You can also store much larger items in these compartments, and Again, with the labeling, because you want to know what's inside, you could easily smack a label on here and then have these stacked up wherever you may want to put them. And then when you're ready to find a certain item, use a certain item, you just go and look at the label and be like, oh, these are all, you know, the cutouts of animals, or these are all my old letters, and you can go right to that. Now, you also can use, honestly, again, if you want to save money and you don't want to spend a lot on storage, you can use your old shoe boxes. This isn't paper that's worth thousands of dollars. So if you store it in a shoebox, it's okay. IKEA has these cardboard boxes. You put them together. It's almost similar to a shoebox. I think these are less than a dollar. I think they were less than a dollar a piece, or maybe a dollar. And again, holds enough. You can either write on the side, slap the sticker on there so that you could always in the future change what you store in there by putting another sticker on top. Easy to stack, easy to store. You could slide it under a bed in a spare room, put it on a shelf in a closet in a spare room. And I use these as well. I also, when I go to many auctions or estate sales, there are the, you know, decorative boxes or decorative shoe boxes that you do see at craft stores. And they run anywhere between $5 to like 20 bucks. If they're on sale, you might get it for $3. But going to auctions and estate sales, I come across them. And, you know, if it's a dollar for a whole tote of them, sign me up, I will buy it. Because that's saving money, it's being thrifty, and it's cheaper than buying at the store. That same with the like the plastic storage containers with the shelves. Those are expensive. And the ones that I've gotten, I've either gotten them on sale, again at Michael's with a coupon, or I have gotten them at auctions. Sometimes at auctions they can sell for the amount that they sell from the store because it's convenient for someone to just be like, hey, you know, I actually need that storage container, so I'll just buy it here. You know, storing your paper, it doesn't need to be fancy. If you're just starting out, you can use your shoe boxes. You can use what you have and then work up to it. You know, work up to perhaps more shelving, more organizational cubbies and things like that when you have a nice big cottage that you can work from. Dreams. But that's how I store my paper. Again, I just think that if, you know, if you're going to be cutting up the paper, folding it, cutting up books, there's no need to spend a lot of money on what you're putting those items in. It's different for the documents and the ephemera that mean something to you, that has emotional value or monetary value. You do want to protect that and make sure that you're storing that in the right way so that it can last, it can continue to last. Now, we know, you know, maybe great 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 Uncle Al's photos were found in an attic in the old house, but if we can kind of stop that deteriorating for the next generation, then store it in a nice archival box. That's how I store my paper. Nothing fancy, nothing crazy. It works for me. It might not work for you. You might think that is the dumbest way to store things, and that's fine. That's how I store my paper. People have been asking. I thought I would provide a little quick answer, but I don't think that was too quick. Anyway, on to the next part with my upcoming junk journal. Now, what is a junk journal? There's so many definitions for that as well. So basically the premise of it is a book that is made from ephemera, recycled materials, old paper, paper scraps, etc. You can use a junk journal for whatever you want. It can just sit on a shelf and look nice. You can use it to, you know, put notes in it, doodle, a to-do list, a diary, whatever your heart desires. And I think that that is something that's nice about junk journals. You know, there isn't one definitive definition, so they kind of all kind of merge together. Same as with how do you put together a junk journal. I've been looking at junk journal YouTube channels and there's many. There are people that do things similar and there are people that do things totally different. You have the no-sew, the sewing, using an old book, not using an old book. So there's so many ways to make a junk journal. Now, as I mentioned in a previous video, my junk journal is going to be focused on or centered around the religious paper that I have found because I have come across a lot of it. I love the colors. I think that the illustrations are beautiful. And let's start there. So I have some of the material together that I'm using now. For those that do junk journals, perhaps you can offer me some advice. My plan is to use this book. It's Heavenly Light number 2. And it has hymns inside. Hymnal book with hymns inside. I'm going to leave it as is. Now, I might want to reinforce the spine to give it a little bit more reinforcement. But I plan on keeping the pages just as they are. I'm not cutting them out. I'm not removing them. Keeping them as is. So this is going to be my base. I hope it's an okay one. Then I have some other things that I would like to add. So this is an old hymnal book. It's falling apart already, but we have all these little pages in here that I would like to use. I have just, I probably have a whole box of these. So these are little Bible lesson pictures. We have those, some have a bit more wear than others. And then on the back, we have the lesson. So I can use the front or the back. But again, I just really love the colors and I think that the illustrations are really nice. So we have those. We have a verse a day to keep the tempter away. This little cute book, which I mean, you could probably use this as a junk journal in it itself. But there are all these little things that you would check off on how to keep the tempter away. Let not your heart be troubled. Yes, we have that. I absolutely love this postcard. So the postcard shows a church on the front. Now I looked up this postcard to see if it's worth anything and I might get like $3 for it. So I thought, you know what? I want to use it. I like how it looks. Let's use it. But there's a church on the front and then there's the pastor and then it has this is your parish to go along to. Wait, no, this is the church, sorry. This is the church you promised to go along to. So I would like to use that as well. So will it fit? I might have to do some cutting out of that, but I guess I could probably cut along. We'll figure it out. Maybe I'll save it for another one. I don't know. So we have that. And then we have some other just little, again, bits of paper, things that I have found along the way. Another postcard. And this, I liked a sacred token. Cut this out of an old book. We have a map of the Holy Land. These might be too big. I have to cut it down a little bit, I think. So that's just a little bit of the paper that I have. Now I have to learn all about, they make pockets. There are pages called signature pages. I don't know if this is the type of book to put a signature page. I don't even know if this type of book, I mean, I want to use this. I just have to look and see how I can use this so that it can be used to the best of its ability. I really like the cover. I just think it's nice. And I think that this would be appropriate to start my religious ephemera-based junk journal. So that's where I am. Oh, and I also have some bits of linens and doilies and things like that to use. We'll have to see. It's a journey that I'm on, and again, any recommendations, tips, tricks that you know of would be appreciated. I'm just gonna be looking on YouTube and seeing what videos are out there that can also help me. But that's today's paper adventure. Just some advice, not really advice, I guess just a little bit insight onto how I store my paper, and then also the progress that I've made on my junk journal, gathering materials together. I purchased more glue based on recommendations from some other viewers. I have some better scissors, so I think I'm on my way. Stay tuned for more adventures, whether it's the paper, the flea market, the auction, or estate sale kind. And if you know you are just delving into the world of ephemera, I welcome you. It's a great one. Thanks for watching. Have a great day, and I'll see you all next time for the next adventure here at Paper and Moose. Thank you.